Well, the very first thing I'd like to say is that I'm extremely pleased to be with you today and to spend this whole week in Belgium. It's an occasion for me to meet old friends and to meet new ones and to become more aware of Belgian science. What I've already seen and heard yesterday and today confirms me about the quality of what is going on in health sciences in your country. So many thanks to the Indian Princess Foundation for providing me with this chance, this opportunity to spend this week in Belgium. Really, I thank you very much. Michel, thank you also for your introduction. It was too kind, that's for sure. But now I will try to tell you a few words about some general ideas that are connected a little bit with my research, but it's not directly implanted in my research about, as you can read, immunity and genetics as health determinants. I went too quickly. So this picture is the picture of the building Michel mentioned, Institut Imagine, which is on the Boulevard Montparnasse, for those of you who know Paris. This is on the campus of the Necker Hospital. And this building has been erected 5 years ago by the famous architect Jean Nouvel. It's a pretty good place to work. If there are some young people here or less young people who one day would be interested to come to work with us, there are 500 scientists, 26 groups working in different fields of medical research related to genetic diseases in many different areas, not only immunology. And the spirit of what we are doing is on this cartoon I got from a Japanese friend. So this is a typical ground round, but you know, you can see that the ground round is filled with people of different origins. So on the left-hand side, human doctors, but on the other side, these are mice doctors. Of course, it's an image, but this image is very strongly representative of what we, as well as others, of course, in other places, are trying to do. That is to mix, to integrate as much as possible medicine with research, including basic research. And of course, in health sciences, in biology, murine models are pretty useful with some limitation. So that we are trying to do this. And there is a reality behind that, of course, not with mice directly, but that is at ground rounds where cases are discussed. There are scientists, including non-MD scientists. And of course, conversely, during scientific talks, many of the MDs attend, and we try to make sure that the young people attend. So this is really the spirit of what we are trying to do. Okay, having said that, what I'd like to discuss with you, start with this. So these are the immense challenges of our immune system. Our body is at the interface with the external medium, for instance. There is the skin. In an adult, approximately 2 square meters of surface of skin, slightly less. And on the skin, there is a lot of microbes. We are living in good peace with many bacteria as well as other macroorganisms, fungi that are sitting on our skin. If you go now to the respiratory tract, the overall surface of the respiratory tract in an adult is something like 140 square meters, so it's pretty big. And interestingly enough, the lungs are normally clean of microbes. They are kept clean, so the system works in a way that microbes are not supposed to settle, whereas the upper respiratory tract, the throat and so on, is full of microbes. And again, we are living in peace with those microbes. And then if we go to the gut, another place of interface with the external world, the overall surface of the gut, where nutrients are absorbed, is something like around 300 square meters, even bigger, a very large house, if I may say so. So in the part of our gut, especially in the colon, there are many, many bacteria. It's estimated that the number is, as indicated, something like 3 × 10^13, so which means 10,000 billions of bacteria belonging to more than 1,000 different species. There are even more viruses, including viruses circulating in our blood all the time, phages, not in principle not pathogenic viruses. There are also fungi and parasites. So which means that we should not consider ourselves as being one entity without any contact with any living organism. Actually, we are full of microbes. And in our body, if we include the gut, there are more microbes than there are cells in our body. So one of my colleagues, Philippe Sansonetti, who's a famous microbiologist in Paris, is used to say that we are the parasites of our microbes. Okay? Well, this is quite serious. So still we have an immune system, and this immune system is regulating this very complex interplay between us and the external world. Of course, there are defenses. So if I take the image of an army, and we are fighting pathogenic microbes, and there are many pathogenic microbes that from time to time are trying to invade us through the different mucosae or skin or all the other ways. And our immune system, as I will discuss briefly in a second, have weapons to fight these microbes. But at the same time, we want to live in peace. We want to live in peace with these non-pathogenic microbes, the common cells that are, as I said, very numerous on our skin, in the gut, in the throat, for instance. And so there's a kind of trade-off, and which is the topic for very intense research these days to understand exactly how it works. So we maintain them, we prevent them to invade our body, but still we do not want to exclude them. We don't want to destroy them. We need them for our health. And finally, there is a third challenge for our immune system, is that we do not want our immune system to recognize our own components, because if they do that, they will induce what is called an autoimmune disease. And I will talk a little bit later about autoimmune diseases. And autoimmune diseases, of course, are a very important aspect of medicine these days. And this is where the system doesn't work properly. So an immune system at work, fight pathogenic microbes, trade off with common cells, and ignore our self molecules. So this is pretty a challenge to ensure all of these properties. So how do we do that? To be very, very oversimplifying the immune system, which is pretty complex, there are two kinds of weapons. The innate immune system, which is shared actually by all cells of our body, including epithelial cells in the skin, neurons in the brain, and so on. And we have, this is on the left-hand side panel, we have a series of molecules with these strange names, TLR, NLR, CLR, RLR, CGAS. These are molecules that are present either at the surface of cells, like the TLR here, or inside cells, either in endosomes, like these TLR, or in the cytosol of cells, the cytoplasm. And these molecules, they are receptors that can bind to molecules from the external world, so molecules from microbia, so they detect the presence of microbes. But also they can detect some what we call danger signals, that is cells that have been attacked by any kind of mechanisms, whether it's a microbe or a toxic substance. And the release of these endogenous danger molecules can also trigger a very rapid response from the immune system, which is inflammation, that may start within minutes. It goes very quickly. And one important function of innate immunity is shown on the right-hand side panel, which is electron microscopy picture, and then the explanation on the right-hand side of this is a phagocytic cell, a neutrophil, so one of the white cells we have in our blood, and you can see that it is at this time eating a bacteria itself being dividing. You can see that here. Okay, so the outcome of this phagocytosis will be that this bacteria will go into a special organelle in which toxic products will be released that will kill the bacteria. So this is one of the mechanisms by which we are preventing invasion by pathogenic bacteria. So this is the first innate immunity, which in evolution is extremely ancient. It can be detected, for instance, the so-called TLR, these molecules, the genes encoding these molecules are present in species that live at least 750 million years ago. It's a very ancient system of defense. Then, thank you. The second arm is so-called adaptive immunity. It's more recent. It appeared in evolution about 500 million years ago. It's very young. So it's very different. It is based on lymphocytes, another subset of leukocytes, the cells that are circulating in our blood, but are also present in lymph nodes and organ and the spleen, for instance. And they are deriving from precursor cells like stem cells in the bone marrow, but the important point is that during differentiation, during development, every single cell becomes different from another, and it is different by the molecule that is present at the surface, which is depicted here as being different, which is the molecule by which they recognize the antigen, so the substances inducing an immune response. So which means at the time there will be a recognition of an antigen, this red circle here, say from a flu virus, for instance, only a few of these lymphocytes will be activated. They will divide. It takes time, several days. So this immune response is much slower to be initiated compared to the innate immune system. But then these cells will be activated. They will exert a certain number of effective functions, and that will usually lead to destruction of the pathogen. And a few cells will be preserved. They are not dying, all of them, once the microbe has been eliminated. And there are more cells here than there were there. And this is the memory of the immune system on which vaccination is based. We have more cells now, either B lymphocytes making antibodies or T lymphocytes providing cellular immunity. We have more cells than we had prior to the contact with the microbe. So if we are for the second time infected with the same pathogen, we'll have a much quicker and efficient response. And this is how vaccination is protecting ourselves. Vaccination against measles prevents the occurrence of measles. This is the basis of this adaptive immune system. One example of the many effector functions that are used by lymphocytes to eliminate microbes is what you will see, hopefully, the fact that some of the lymphocytes can kill other cells. And they are killing cells that are infected. But on the bottom image, you were supposed to see killing lymphocytes, killing another target cell. But okay, I hope you will trust me that this system does exist in vivo. And this is very efficient to kill cells infected with a virus and sometimes other microorganisms, other pathogens. So it's one main mechanism among many others. And you have the cartoon indicating the release of the toxic product here, killing the cell. It's extremely effective. Actually, these cells are serial killers. That is, they can kill a cell and then 20 minutes later starts to kill another one, another one, and another one. They're extremely efficient in protecting us against especially viral infections. Okay, so this was a very brief and summarized picture of our immune system, how we fight microbes, but also how we try not to fight the microbes. We do not want to fight those at the surface of our body. And now I have to go back to evolution of the human, of humans, and not just here considering modern humans, so Homo sapiens sapiens. That probably appeared something on this figure. It is indicated minus 200,000 years ago. Actually, it's probably, we know, 300,000 years ago. So the modern humans. So modern humans have co-evolved up to now with many different microbes that are pathogenic. And these microbes were killing people, but our immune system from time to time, fortunately, killed the microbes. And both the microbes and we have evolved one against the other. So there are multiple examples you can read on this slide, and with real timing, approximately real timing. For instance, tuberculosis, I will tell you a little bit more about tuberculosis. We know that Mycobacterium tuberculosis, Bacille de corps, has co-evolved with humans for something like 100,000 years, for instance. If you go to leprosy, it's more recent, about 12,000 years. Cholera, something like 5,000 years. Plague, approximately 2,000 years. And modern infections like measles, diphtheria, and so on developed at the time. People were starting to live together. So you can see on this, here you have the history of humankind. That is, it started with migration from Africa with very small groups of people who were diverse, so that if there was an infection, it will kill only a small group of people, not the whole community, because the people were separated. But then a very important transition occurred approximately 10,000 years ago, which is the beginning of agriculture. So at the time people started to create villages to work and live together with animals, so that more zoonoses appeared, and in bad infection occurred, it could kill all of the village. So the consequences became different. And obviously more recently, there is urbanization. So people are living inside cities more and more. As you know, this is again changing very much the interaction between microbes and humans. And over the last 500 years, we have started to move from one place to another very rapidly these days, so that infections can split and spread rather than split very, very rapidly. So my point here, and I will come back to that, there is a considerable, as you can read, selective pressure on the immune system that is provoked by microbes, you know, so that we could resist and some of us at least can survive. I remind you, for instance, that plague in 14th century killed approximately one-third of the population of Western Europe, but still two-thirds survived. And they survived probably because they had the strong elements genetically determined that helped them to kill the bacillus pestis responsible of that. So there is a mutual pressure on the genetic system of humans and microbes. And this is ongoing. And just one example, tuberculosis. There has been a very nice study performed by geneticists from Spain about the history of tuberculosis. So what they sequenced the genome of Mycobacterium tuberculosis of 259 strains that they isolated in patients all over the world. And they reconstituted the history of Mycobacterium tuberculosis by the reconstituting the phylogenetic tree with the different mutations that occurred in the genome of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And what is extremely impressive, as shown on this scheme, so that with the figures are dates. So when you read 73, it means minus 73,000 years ago. So the way Mycobacterium tuberculosis spread is exactly the same way as human beings have spread from Africa. So which means that Mycobacterium tuberculosis and human beings have followed the same route, just because Mycobacterium tuberculosis is a parasite of humans. And Mycobacterium tuberculosis can kill people, as you may know, but not always. Interestingly enough, for 10 people infected with this bacteria, only one will develop tuberculosis. The 9 others will, in the absence of treatment, will cope with the bacteria. And this is the topic of very important research to understand the genetic determinants that protect most of the population from TB, whereas one-tenth of the population is sensitive to TB and may die in the absence of treatment. And another way of looking at it in a very, very, spectacular way, it's a bit more complex, but here, what is shown on the x-axis, the horizontal axis, is the time. So starting from minus 60,000 years ago to now, and on the y-axis is the diversity of the genome, so the occurrence of mutations and how the genome diversified, in blue, this is for the human genome, looking at the genome of the mitochondria. So this is a special genome easy to look at. You see what is interesting is the slope. So you see diversity is increasing, but then about approximately 10,000 years ago, the slope is now much steeper, indicating actually there were more people, a more diverse genome. And now if you look in red at the genome of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, it follows exactly the same pattern, which suggests that at the time when people were together in villages and small cities, starting about approximately 10,000 years ago, there were more people, which were some of them susceptible to Mycobacterium tuberculosis. So Mycobacterium tuberculosis has the chance to mutate, so there were more strains. So again, this is the demonstration, retrospective demonstration, but a very nice one, that Mycobacterium tuberculosis has co-evolved with human beings, one chasing the other. And the outcome of it is favorable to humans, but with a tragedy. As I said, among 10 people infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, 9 will be cured spontaneously. The last 10th, if there is no treatment, so this was the case up to the 20th century, will die. So which means that, if I say that in a very sportive manner, men won against tuberculosis by 9-1. But still one means, and this is a tragedy, if you just make an estimation for the last 200 years, 1 billion people have died from tuberculosis, which is of course enormous. And still today, Mycobacterium tuberculosis is the first cause of death among all of the infectious diseases in the world. Okay, so this is, of course, one example among many others. So as I said, the genome is evolving, and the poor Darwin, which is shown not in a very sympathetic way by the people who didn't like Darwin, but Darwin, of course, with his theory, was instrumental about understanding evolution of living species, including humans. So there are mutations, modification of the genome, I will come back to that in a second, as well as mixing different populations, followed by selection that can modify the genome and specifically the genes that are involved in immune responses. It is estimated that we have approximately 22,000 genes in our genome. Approximately 2,000 of them, so slightly less than 10%, are specifically involved in immune responses. So there is a major investment, if I may say so, of our biology that is associated with preserving us from dying from infections, but also, again, keeping peace with the good bacteria and the good microbes. I remind you, for those who are not in the field, that mutations comes on the sequence of the DNA, which is a code based on the different purine and pyrimidine bases, and that there is a code with three letters, so that each three letters, ACTG, and there are words of three letters that encodes at the level of translation into a protein, into an amino acid. So if there are changes, like the one shown here, there could be a change that doesn't change the amino acid code. So here from TCA, you go to TCC, there still will be a serine. So it's a neutral change, no consequences. But then here, if you go from TCA to CCA, instead of a serine, the protein will contain a proline, another amino acid. This is a very significant change, and this may alter very significantly the function of the protein. Or another possibility, which is even more dramatic, is that from TCA, if you go to TAA, so a mistake C being replaced by A, you get a message that there is a stop in the synthesis of the protein, so you have a truncated product that's likely not going to work. So these mutations do occur. They occur all the time. And just to give you an example, and this may explain also the persistence of genetic diseases, but also accounts for evolution. This is a very interesting observation that was published now 6-7 years ago, where what was done is to sequence the genome of babies and to compare the genome of babies with the genome of the parents and count how many differences there are between the genome of the parents and the genome of the baby that appear because of mutations. So they did it in several trios. So the trios is composed of the father, the mother, and the child, obviously. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And interestingly, there is something related to the phase of father's age. I will come back to that. But all together, if you combine the mean, that there are 70 different base pair of the DNA that differ between the child and the parents, so 70 mutations on average. So the calculation is that there is 1.2 mutation per 100 million nucleotides or base pairs per generation. So this is not that rare. Of course, most of these mutations are neutral. It doesn't change anything because either they are neutral in the gene itself or they're occurring in regions of the genome that are not encoding for a gene. But it is estimated, as you can read, that 10% of them are potentially deleterious, so that they can block the synthesis of a very important protein, such as hemoglobin in people who may develop anemia, or sometimes could be beneficial, that will help people to fight an infection. So this is how evolution can occur. By the way, this is not an important message in this context, but you can read that if, as a function of the age of the father, from 21.8 to 40, the number of mutations augments, which indicates that these mutations occur during the differentiation of the spermatozoids because they go along many, many cycles of cell division, and this is the time at which mutations occur. So the parent's age, and specifically the father's age, has an influence. But this is here a minor point. Okay, so based on these events that are not so rare, then selection events can occur. You have mutations, they can be neutral, again, nothing will happen. They could provide an advantage, or they could go with a disadvantage. So they are different at the population level, not talking about individuals here, but at population level. different kinds of selection events may occur. The first one, as written here, this is based on a study of a very talented scientist interested in evolution genomics. Luis Quintana Mossi is working in Paris at the Pasteur Institute. So here, every single gray band represents one given individual. And in blue are mutations or variations, and as well as in black. So what is called purifying selection will mean there is a mutation has occurred in someone, but this mutation is probably deleterious. So it will not be conserved. So these are the black circles on the middle panel, and you see during evolution, it will take some thousand years, there is no longer any black circle. So indicating that for a given gene, if it is under purifying selection processes, it means that we'll look by sequencing the very same gene in many different individuals, we will not find any single variation because they have been kicked out because they were deleterious in terms of evolution. The second profile is positive selection. This is just the reverse. A mutation occurs, this is the red circle in one given individual, but it provides this person with an advantage, for instance, resistance to plague. So the people, the progeny of this individual will better survive in the context of infection, and time after time, there will be more people carrying this mutation that is positively selected, okay, just the reverse. And then there's something a bit more complicated, I will not go into too many details, there could be balancing selection that is an advantage to have a population with different alleles, different variants, different mutations, if you like, at the same gene. This is the case, for instance, for the HLA genes, the genes of histocompatibility. Okay, so these are the three ways by which selection events occur, negatively or positively selecting events that occur initially just by chance. There is an additional mechanism that has been found a few years ago, which is quite spectacular. I'm sure you have heard about it. That is, Homo sapiens sapiens has not lived alone. He has, in some places, probably in the western part of Asia, living together from time to time with Neanderthal, which is an ancient human individual. And they had mixed together so that we know today that if we look in our genome of Europeans, say, we have a little bit of alleles, so variants of genes, coming from Neanderthal. And actually, there is even another archaic, so-called archaic human population in Asia, Denisova, and for at least some of the people in Asia and Oceania, they have some alleles derived from this very ancient population. So we know that this admixing between Neanderthal and Homo sapiens occurred approximately 50,000 years ago, and it led to the fact that we have approximately 2 to 5% of our alleles that are originating from Neanderthal, if we just consider the Neanderthal Homo sapiens sapiens admixing. And interestingly enough, now if we focus on genes associated with immune responses, the frequency of alleles, of variations in the genome, coming from Neanderthal is even bigger, which tells us that by admixing with Neanderthals, there has been selection events that have protected us, descendants, from some infections, very likely. So this is quite spectacular. This is the case, for instance, from genes encoding the TLR, toll-like receptor molecules, I mentioned earlier. Okay, sorry, I don't know why. Back to purifying selection. These are examples. In red, these are many proteins associated with innate immunity. Some of them I showed you in a more simpler way on a previous slide. But here you can see, just as an example, if we take this molecule, here TLR7, TLR8, TLR9, important molecules, so in the detection of an infection, they are painted in red on this slide, which means they are under very strict purifying selection. So evolution is not tolerating any variation in these genes, indirectly telling us that these genes are very important to cope with infections. So, of course, this is helping to understand what is crucial, critical, among the many molecules involved in immune responses. But at the individual level, this purifying selection, of course, is a major disadvantage for people who carry such mutations, and these are the genetic diseases. Just to give you an example in my field, immunodeficiencies, so these inherited homogenic diseases, of course, medically speaking, are drama, but bioscientifically speaking, they are also contributing to help us to decipher what are the most important molecules, since once they are if they are defective, we have a phenotype, infections, for instance, or other immunopathological reactions. And we have today identified many of such mutations. The curve, this is as a function of time, and you can read that today there are more than 350 different monogenic diseases that have been characterized, that corresponded to single mutations. At the population level, they are eliminated, but for individuals who carry them, obviously, this is a drama, this is an infection. So they all together, they account for 1 in 3,000 live births. I will not go into details, just to tell you that these advances occurred very recently. If I go back to 1980, when I was a resident in medicine, so PID, which stands for primary immunodeficiencies, none of them were characterized at the level of genes, zero. We knew that there were cells coming from the bone marrow here that give rise to the cells making antibodies, the T lymphocytes, and some diseases there also, some diseases in this process of killing bacteria by neutrophils, but we knew almost nothing. Today, just to change you the change, to show you the changes, this is about deficiencies causing an inability to make antibodies. Of course, I will not detail this slide, but every time you can read a strange name like here CD40L, this is a gene and a disease. So many of them have been characterized. If I go to T lymphocytes, even worse, these are the many molecules and pathways involved in activation of these cells. Each time a molecule here is circled in brown or red, I don't know exactly, this is a disease that has been characterized. So these processes of negative selection, again, is very important at the level of population, but also for at the individual level, these are genetic diseases. Back to positive selection now, so I will spend a bit of time about it because I think this is quite interesting to assess what's going on these days. So I remind you, this is the occurrence of a mutation providing an advantage. And in the immune system, this is essentially in the way to fight infections, so that these people will survive and more people in the population will carry the mutation here marked by the red circle. Examples of these things, for instance, one example outside of the field of immunology about nutrition, but a very spectacular one. We know that in several places in the world, specifically in Europe on one side, in Africa, south of Sahara, a second time, a mutation occurred in individuals that in a part of the gene that is regulating the expression of an enzyme named lactase. Lactase is a very important enzyme because it cuts the lactose, the sugar which is in the milk, so that babies can use these sugars for their growth. And as you can read, 8,000-9,000 years ago, people had a promoter in a way that only babies had lactase, whereas later on during life, lactase is no longer expressed, there is no protein, no enzyme, so that people could not use milk for nutrition. Okay, so the mutation occurred that allows adults to still have lactase, and this mutation was positively selected, and was positively selected, interestingly enough, at the time when agriculture started. So this makes sense. So the persistence in adults of lactase gene expression, which is present in more than half of the European population today, for instance, of course provide an advantage. They can use now milk for nutrition, not only as a baby, but during all life. And obviously, this provided a major advantage to populations at the stage of transition from what they were before, gatherers, hunters, to the time of becoming farmers. So that's a very well-known event of positive selection, and that occurred at least twice, so what we call convergent evolution, so independent events leading to the same phenomenon, very important during human evolution. And now if we go to this positive selection, I will show you that something that has been benefited from some time, again, helping us to fight an infection, maybe then later on disadvantages. Let me explain that to you. if we go with some examples. So obviously our genome is interacting with our environment by definition. So if there are mutations, this is going to change the red circle, the genome. But then in our environment, there are many factors that are modifying our way of life and may have ultimately, eventually, the consequences of the selection in the genome. Of course, the microbes, but also other aspects less related to immunology, like nutrients. There was the example with the milk, the climate, the temperature, the oxygen pressure, and so on. And they are all forces that may, with more or less intensity, modify our way of life and inducing effect on our genome. So let's take a few examples of positive changes with secondary negative consequences. There is a beautiful work by one of your most famous contemporaneous Belgian scientists, Etienne Pays, who is a parasitologist who worked on trypanosomiasis. What he has shown, there are variant alleles of the genes encoding APOL1, whatever the gene is, this is not a problem, which confer resistance to the parasitic disease trypanosomiasis, which is a sleeping disease, still killing people in Africa. So people who have a certain variant of APOL1 do resist better to trypanosomiasis. And we know that such variants have been selected over evolution. But, and this is a big but, the very same people who carry the variant of APOL1 that protect them against trypanosomiasis now are at risk for progressive kidney failure, because the protein is important for the function of the kidney. So this is not related to, it's only partially related to immunology, but this is an example where a selection event was positive, but then could be also negative. Other very famous examples about malaria, so another very important infectious disease still being unfortunately present in Central Africa and other places. We know that some mutations in the hemoglobin gene are conferring resistance of red cells to infection by malaria. And malaria, the plasmodium, the parasite, is infecting the red cells. So it explains why the mutation that caused at the homozygous level, so if both alleles are mutated, the sickle cell disease, very bad anemia, which is frequent in populations from Central Africa, has been, so this mutation has been maintained, because if you have a single copy of the mutation, you are protected against a certain form of malaria. So advantage and disadvantage. Same story with an enzyme of red cells, which is JCSPD, exactly the same story. So there is no univocal effects of mutations, could be in a certain circumstances helping, contributing to life, but also being deleterious. And I will show you more examples of that. But now I'd like to go a little bit more in complexity. Sorry about that. So there is the genome, the epigenome, that is the way the genome is regulated, how genes are transcribed into a messenger RNA, the environment. But we also have now to consider with human beings the behavior, and we do not always behave in a very, very rational manner. So of course, this is interacting in all possible ways. If you consider tobacco, it's a, probably I can say a bad behavior. This has an influence on our health, because this is causing, for instance, lung cancer. And this is, but there are some genetic variations that may preserve or, in contrast, favoring the usage of tobacco. So there are multiple interactions in different ways. But interestingly enough, these three dependent variables, variations in the genome, so mutations, variation in environment, of course we may change environment, different context of microbes around us, of a different temperature and so on, and we may change our behavior. And what is important is that the kinetics of evolution is completely different. The way our genome is evolving is extremely slow, at least at the population level. It will take at least 1,000 years, and more often even more, to have a significant change at the populational level of our genome. The change in environment may go much faster. If there is an epidemic, it could be even very quick. And usually, I would say, at least it requires 10 years to see a significant change. But the way we change behaviors can occur next day. Tomorrow, I can decide to take drugs or whatever, and so to change completely my behavior. So these variables are influencing one to the other, but there's a different kinetic. So we may think that the consequences are as follows. Now, as a function of time and in terms of adaptation, you have a slow evolution of the genome, and the behavior may change very rapidly, and it could be at the population level. The population can decide, for instance, not to vaccinate themselves at all, and there will be more infections and more deaths, obviously. So there is a kind of potential disadaptation that may cause diseases. And there are examples not related to the immune system, like type 2 diabetes, obesity, populations, and this has been very clearly shown in Pacific Islands, who had a certain style of living, that was adapted to the population. Once they become colonized by people from the Western world, they started to drink Coca-Cola, and this is really like that for some of them, and to eat burgers. And for instance, there is the island in Polynesia, Nauru Island, where it was known that at the beginning of the 20th century, there was zero case of diabetes, almost zero, and no obesity. And today, 60% of the population is obese and has type 2 diabetes, just because there is a change of behavior in nutrition, whereas obviously their genome has not changed in 60 years. It is still a genome of people who are living in much more difficult situations. And for the immune system, it's probably even more striking with the advent in the recent world of more frequent, as you will see, occurrence of allergic diseases, autoimmune diseases, and inflammation. And this is probably in part a consequence of the fact that there is a disadaptation between our microbiological environment, maybe also behavior, like usage of antibiotics, for instance, and our genome. Examples of that. But first of all, so another way to translate what I said about disadaptation is to consider energy expenditure. So every day we eat something like at least something like 2,000 calories required for our body to work properly. Among these 2,000 calories, a certain part will be used to maintain our immune system. So if the needs of fighting infections is reduced in a cleaner environment, as it is the case in the Western world, unfortunately, the system will not adapt, and we are still going to use too much energy to make our immune system to work. So our immune system becomes disadapted from the needs. Okay, so there is, it's like if you have a budget in a country, at a given time, the country is in peace, and maybe you think that it could be a good idea to reduce the military expenses. But we do not do that. We still have high-level military expenses. At the time, we do not need them anymore. And these military expenses are used by the military, and sometimes they make mistakes that are at our expense. I will show you the examples. This is the desertification. And one of the examples are the autoimmune diseases. There are many autoimmune diseases. It is estimated in the adult population that somewhere between 7 to 10% of people have an autoimmune disease, so this is quite frequent and could be significant. There are many different diseases. I will not go into details. This is not only genetics. We know it's environmentally determined too, but there is some genetics behind. And just to show it to you, if we consider some examples of autoimmune diseases like lupus, Crohn's disease, type 1 diabetes, psoriasis, skin disease, multiple sclerosis, or rheumatoid arthritis. So you have the prevalence, so the frequency in the European population, and you see the second column is interesting. It tells you if they are monozygotic twins, what is the probability that the second twin will get the disease? Of course, the higher it is, the higher is the chance that this is a disease determined by genetic traits. So I will not go into details, but let's take Crohn's disease. You can see among different data, if a twin, monozygotic twin, has a Crohn's disease, the second twin has a chance of between 20 to 50% to develop the disease, which is very high, which indicates that there is a genetic component, also shown by the risk for siblings, which is higher than for the general population. And I will skip that, not to be too long. And now I will show you examples to tell you, to try to convince you that because previous evolution of our genome to fight infections is also leading to autoimmunity. So the selection comes by resistance to microbes, again, mycobacteria, hepatitis C virus, invasive bacteria. So they select in our genome variants that help us to fight these infections. But now what has been determined is that some of these variants that have been selected by pathogens, indirectly, of course, are predisposing to infection. Here are a few examples. For instance, some people who have a given allele of a gene called MDA5, which is involved in innate immunity, is associated more frequently with the occurrence of psoriasis. If I take a more better known HLA-DQ, so one of the HLA molecules, we know that certain alleles of HLA-DQ associated with celiac disease, gluten intolerance, which is occurring is approximately 1% of the population. By the way, these emerge again at the time of agriculture with a change in environment and behavior. But so it's good to have certain alleles of HLA-DQ to fight certain pathogens, but it increases the risk to develop the gluten intolerance, the celiac disease. Other examples here shown in a different way. You have the different diseases, celiac, again, diabetes, lupus, and so on. And everything which is above this dotted line are genes with an increased risk, or alleles of a given gene with an increased risk of autoimmune diseases. And we know that these alleles have been selected by pathogen. So better fight against a given infection at a given time, but then a risk of autoimmunity. So you see the positive followed by the negative aspects. No, you know, not to be too long, I will skip some of the slides because we will be there, if not for 2 hours, which is maybe not a good idea, and go immediately to this. So the global picture is as follows, and this has been named by several scientists, the first Strachan in the US, Jean-François Bach in France, the hygiene hypothesis, what it is. So if you look at the picture, the global picture of the incidence of infections of the left-hand side panel, and the global incidence of some of the autoimmune diseases as well as inflammatory, you know, allergic diseases like asthma, you see the reverse picture in mirrors. So the good news, of course, is that at least in the Western world, the frequency of infections such as tuberculosis, measles, hepatitis A, and so on, is declining very dramatically, as you can see, between the years 1950 to 2000 for many reasons, for hygiene, vaccination, antibiotics, and so on. But then, at the very same time, you see the very steep increase in the frequency of Crohn's disease, so the inflammatory disease of the bowel, of multiple sclerosis, of type 1 diabetes, and also, it's even more dramatic, of asthma, so of allergic diseases. So it looks like there is a mirror image which suggests, doesn't demonstrate it, that the fact that we are less frequently infected by viruses and bacteria may predispose us, perhaps for some of the reasons I just showed you, to develop more frequently immunopathological diseases. But because our immune system is very simple words, has been tuned to fight infections during the past because that was the only way to survive. And today we do not need that level of fight. So this is the army that is receiving too much credit in the budget of a given country and making mistakes. Mistakes are allergy and autoimmune diseases, if I keep this image. And interestingly enough, if I take the example of allergy, we know today that this is probably mostly determined during early childhood. And there is the work here in Ghent of Bart Lambrecht, who is a superb scientist working on this. That has shown some of these aspects. But I will show you some epidemiological data that are supporting the concept that our environment during the first 5 years of life is determining part of the risk of developing allergy or inflammation, inflammatory diseases. These are studies that have been performed in Germany and Switzerland. What has been done is to compare the frequency at which patients are developing asthma, lung disease, everybody knows, or atopy on the right-hand side, skin disease, eczema, comparing two groups of patients, of children, those in brown who have been raised in farms during the first 5 years of life, compared in gray to control groups of children, essentially, of course, living in cities. As you can see, that there is a very significant difference. Of course, this is not black and white. The difference for asthma is the order approximately in 1 to 2, so there are two different cohorts, with the study. So there is reproduction of the data. And for atopy, it's also in a factor on one. So if a child has been raised in a farm during his first 5 years of life, the chance of developing asthma or dermatic atopic dermatitis, excuse me, is reduced by a factor of 2. This is very significant, of course. And more precisely, what has been done is to look at the microbes present in the dust in the children living rooms. So the people went into the rooms where these children are living, and they took particles and analyzed the bacteria on the left-hand side and fungi on the right-hand side panel. You can see the blue curve here. There are two informations here. The blue curve shows that for children living in farm, there is a higher diversity diversity of bacteria, and so they have less asthma, as I told you, excuse me, and there are many more microbes in their environment. The converse for those who develop asthma. Same that was for bacteria, and here for fungi. So, of course, this is correlation, it's not causal demonstration of effect, but so the more bacteria and fungi there are in the room of the child during the first years of life, the lower is the chance to develop an allergic disease. Okay? And even more spectacular, perhaps, is this study, because it has been very carefully done, comparing in the US, the same kind of study, two populations who are genetically very similar because they came from same place in Europe, the Amish, living in some countries, places in the US, and the Utherids, they're all coming from Holland and Western Germany, and they migrated, I think, in the 17th century to the US. And the Amish are used to live in farms where there are animals, whereas the Utherids are used to live in farms that are industrials without animals. So does it make a difference in terms in the risk of allergy? The answer is yes, because the prevalence of asthma in the Amish population, as you can read, is something like 5%, whereas in the Utherid population is 21%, and overall allergic sensitization is 7 against 33. And you can read here that patients from the Utherid population, they are highly consanguineous, both of these populations. They have many more eosinophils in their blood that is indicating of allergy. And if you can read here, there are some figures, for instance, children with asthma among the Amish population, 0 versus 6 out of 30 in the Utherid population. So of course, these are low figures, but still, again, it suggests that presence of animals with a number of microbes associated to them protect the children against allergy. And they have shown even further that looking again, same kind of study of in-house dust, where these people are living, in the Amish homes, so those who are rather protected from allergy, there is a much higher density of endotoxins, that are products originating from bacteria, that are activating the immune system. So the presence of these endotoxins looks to be protective. I will not go into the details of the next slide, which shows that in mice, one can reproduce this data by introducing the endotoxins from the Amish house that is protecting. So which I will skip that because I don't want to be too long. But how can we interpret this data? So this is a bit more complicated, but this is the epithelium of the lung. Let's consider asthma. So these are the epithelial cells, and behind there are cells of the immune system. So allergens come to the periphery, we breathe the allergens, like house dust mites, for instance. They will activate some molecules, like some TLR, and they will induce the epithelial cells to release molecules we call alarmins that are telling the immune system, well, there is something wrong here, there is a danger, you should go ahead. Go ahead, they're activated, and they are activating some kind of T cells, TH2, that will help the B lymphocytes to make IgE, and this IgE is associated with allergy and asthma. In people living in a farming environment with animals that are exposed to many products that are binding to these molecules early on in life, this is actually regulating the system so that instead of activating these cells, it is activating other cells, not leading to asthma. This is not something that is perfectly understood today, but it goes this way. And in another way to describe exactly the same phenomenon, we may consider I can you from here, I can't see, but I hope you can see the red text at the bottom of the slide, which this is the same story. You have allergens like house dust mites, activating the epithelial cells, activating the immune system, the production of IgE. And what it is likely that it is, there is a program that has been selected over evolution that poised the immune systems to make IgE, because in the past, probably IgE, we know it's very important to fight parasites. So probably it was important maybe 20,000 years ago to survive, to be able to fight parasites. But today, this program, when it is turned on by allergens, is toxic. So something that was useful many years ago is now more deleterious. Whereas in the population of people living in farms, as well as in the ancient world, the system is organized in a way that it doesn't induce this phenomenon. And there are more details here. I will not go into the detail, into the different aspects, but that will prevent the occurrence of allergy. Okay, tell me when I should stop. I can stop in 1 minute or 10 minutes or 30 minutes. So please tell me. Just brief, no, seriously, please tell me when I should. Excuse me?
Back to 10.
10, not ten. More than, no, ten. It should be 10. That's right, okay. What I showed you about allergy is maybe true also for inflammatory bowel disease. You have the same kind of epidemiological studies. If you compare population of people living in cities compared to population of people living in villages, compared to population of people living during childhood in farms with animals, the same story. And this is the cumulative occurrence of inflammatory bowel disease, or Crohn's disease. You can easily see that if you live in a city from birth, you are at much higher risk to develop an inflammatory bowel disease than if you were raised in a farm with animals. So these are, could be, have a major impact in terms of healthcare. And these are obviously the consequences of the evolution of our immune system based on our genome that is no longer chronologically synchronous with our environment. Okay, so the conclusions there, actually I will not spend more than 10 minutes. I'm almost done. So our health, as far as the immune system and infections and allergy and so on is considered, but it is also true for nutrition, by the way. Our health is in part determined by consequences of genetic adaptation events that were selected positively and negatively, I mentioned that, that occurred a long time ago, 100,000 years ago, 50,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, in a different environment, natural environment, that is very different, obviously, and I don't think there is much to explain about that, from the environment in which we are living today. And these events still have consequences today because these mutations are still there. Okay, we have not counter-selected these mutations. And maybe now for a more positive aspect, since we understand better, we do not yet understand fully these events, especially this IgM theory, which is extremely interesting, is not fully understood in terms of molecular terms today. But still, there are some good news, since we understand a bit better what's going on, that perhaps science may provide knowledge to at least in part compensate our relative inadaptation to the present environment. It is possible that some kind of vaccination early on during childhood, or perhaps why not, this is a little bit science fiction, but why not, to use extracts from the house dust from the houses of houses where there are animals, so from farms. Perhaps if we induce young children to inhale some of these extracts or to eat them, perhaps this will protect them. Knowing that it would be probably difficult to have all of the children to be raised in farms everywhere. That would be a slight problem. But seriously speaking, we may think to modulate the risk of allergy by such manipulation in the future. This is not yet there, but might be. So to finish with, I'd like to mention a few implications. So what about the future? So I discussed selection events in the past related to infections, a little bit to nutrition and other conditions of life. So could it be that the major diseases that are killing us, so cancer and cardiovascular diseases, could they modify the process of selection for the future? The answer is likely no, because as you know, cancer and cardiovascular diseases occur in adulthood and mostly in individuals once the reproductive time has passed. And what is important is reproduction. Once you have done your children, no matter what is going to happen to you in terms of evolution, you are done. Okay? this is true. Well, almost true. There are a few things. So it's probable, even if there would be an increase, which might be the case in the occurrence of in the rates of cancer and or of cardiovascular diseases, it's not going to modify anything in our genome, even in the long term. But now what about environment? Everybody is talking about environment, climate change, and so on. So this might have an occurrence if it induces major threat to people at an early age. But if medicine can cope with it, this is not going to have an influence. So we don't know. Of course, there could be new infectious agents that will be devastating, new plagues. But this is not that sure that I'm rather optimistic to say what we probably today with the way we can identify microbes and fight microbes by different ways, we may prevent major devastative pandemic with microbes. By major, I mean pandemics that will kill, 250 million people. I'm not talking about the deaths of thousands of people, which is a drama, but has no influence in terms of evolution. Of course, who has to distinguish these levels. So perhaps one way to think about it is to consider perhaps because of modern medicine, because we are able to control most of the infections and many other aspects of medicine, we may prevent actually any further evolution of the human genome, that everything is done if there is no major catastrophe in the future. So perhaps we are at the level that we are not going to move that much from where we are today, which is not, again, fully adapted to our way of life, but not in a way that is not killing us. So it's not provide, there is no advantage in terms of survival of people who are better fit to our environment. So, okay, so the people, so well. Well, still, there is about genetic diseases, even if they are rare. It could be that if we treat better patients who have inherited diseases, we may see an accumulation of deleterious mutations at the germline, because these people will reproduce better than they do today. This is possible, but still extremely limited in numbers, and also possibilities of genetic counseling may limit this risk, but this may be considered. And finally, I think what is most important, to my opinion, in terms of evolution of health, socioeconomic determinants are likely to be much more important for than any genetic features in the time to come. Okay, with this, I will close and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alain. It's really fascinating. I think that we have time for a few questions. So who would like to start? Salvador Romero.
I know this is likely to be a complicated, a simple question, but a complicated answer. Has to do with in the immunological system and cancer. I mean, what is the reason why cancer doesn't, at some point of the genomic mutations of the cell, doesn't elicit a very clear immunological response that recognizes that cell like a non-self and starts attacking it? But that's one part of the question. Sorry. The second part is...
Could I answer the first part, because if not, I will forget, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Perhaps the answer to your question is that in most of the cases, it is inducing an immune response that is very efficient, so that we are killing and preventing occurrence of cancer. And that what we see as a cancer, medically speaking, is the only the emerge part of the iceberg, that perhaps our immune system is preventing 99 cancers out of 100, but still there is the very last one where the immune response for many different reasons is not that efficient.
I always hear that statement. What's the evidence that we have fought successfully hundreds of cancers before ones appear?
I said perhaps. No evidence. Well, there are some I think pathological data, I think about thyroid glands, for instance, for thyroid glands that have been removed because people have hyperthyroidism or things like that. And it is not infrequent to find very small foci of malignant cells, for instance. So not open thyroid cancers, and in a frequency that is much beyond the actual frequency of thyroid cancer. It's not a strong evidence, but it is a suggestion, and it makes some sense. But I agree with you, this is not strictly demonstrated. And then we know that in the cancer cells, when there is, again, this is a play of evolution and selection between the cancer and the immune system. As you know very well, the cancer cells are evolving all the time. There are lots of mutations. Some of them may favor the immune response, indeed, because they are new antigens, and this is clearly demonstrated, but also they have a huge armamentarium to avoid escape immune responses, some protein at the surface not being expressed, like HLA molecules, or having this PD-L1 molecule blocking T cell responses that express PD-1 and so on. As you know, there are many reviews describing hundreds of different mechanisms by which tumors can escape cancer. So the selection of genetic events, somatic events in cancer cells, of course, is aimed at preventing the immune response by selection by the immune system. So there is a play always, a game, if I may say so, between the immune system and the cancer cell.
And do we understand, that was the second part of the question, why some cancer cells are more active in terms of activating the immunological system than other cancer cells? For example, melanoma is very immunologically evident, while prostate is immunologically silent.
There are some suggestions, I'm not sure, I'm not an expert in that field, but there is some suggestion, for instance, from the Dutch colleague Tom Schumacher, who's a specialist of these questions, that there is a correlation, again, not a formal proof, but a correlation between the number of mutations, somatic mutations in the cancer cell generating neoepitopes. So it has to be looked at epitopes that can be presented by HLA molecules to T cells, with immunogenicity and response, for instance, to immunotherapy. So it could be that by chance, I don't know, melanomas are more frequently inducing mutations that are leading to neoantigens that can be recognized by T cells. I think that's a reasonable hypothesis. It correlates pretty well with success of treatment, but this is, again, not fully demonstrated, that's for sure.
Thank you.
Other questions? Yes,
I have a simple question and a small comment to make about the endotoxins. When I was young, I worked quite a lot with endotoxins. And this phenomenon with endotoxins is called tolerance. And I wonder if you expose people, children in particular, to endotoxins, that phenomenon would rather occur if you use endotoxins to provoke fever, for example. Yeah. Very quickly it disappears, the fever, after a couple of times of injection. So that's my question.
Again, if you don't mind, I prefer to answer your first question. As far as I know from the studies with asthma, for instance, in children raised in farms with animals exposed to more frequently to endotoxins, this is not that they are not developing an immune response against the allergen. They have an immune response, but it is on a certain type of immune response that is not causing allergy. So it's essentially not a Th2 response. So it's a diversion of the response, not a yes or no response. It's the way the immune system is turned or tuned to a certain type of response, so actually mostly inducing Th1 as well as also activation of regulatory T cells.
My second simple question that always intrigued me. Children with Down syndrome, what's their immune system towards certain infections and according kind of autoimmune disease also?
Yeah, this is true that patients with Down syndrome, they are a bit more susceptible to some pathogens, and some of them do develop autoimmunity. It's not that clear how it works. There is hyper-expression of some integrins that are encoded by the chromosome 21. But whether this is directly causing some perturbation in immune responses, I'm not sure we know. I don't know, at least. I think it's probably a complex question. But this is true, the observation is very solid. You're absolutely right. But unfortunately, I don't think we know the exact mechanisms today.
The paradigm you proposed regarding adaptation and disadaptation most probably relies on the premises that any gene affected by a mutation that is acquired is expressed over time. And that is probably true at the population level. And I wonder to what extent the regulation by epigenetics, especially by changes in the environment, may disprove the simple theory, yes.
I fully agree. On one of my slides, epi, there was an epi added to genomic, and I fully agree. This is not strictly related to mutations themselves. Obviously, environment is modifying expression of genes by epigenetic regulation, and this may have a strong influence. But this is clear at the individual level, maybe not so clear at the population level on the long term. So this is, I'm not sure about that, but this is, of course, a possibility that has to be considered.
And that's probably what you put in your last sentence, socioeconomic determinants.
Yeah, that will have some epigenetic consequences, too, of course.
So as you know, Alain, we are facing major problems related to antimicrobial resistance, which is really killing more and more people, and we don't see really new antibiotics coming. So what do you think this might have as an impact on all the point that you were discussing today?
Well, in terms of evolution, so at a big population level, I hope it is unlikely to have an influence, because that would mean that the antibody resistance will be so high that it's going to kill 20%, 50% of the population, which we are not there yet. And we may hope that by a better usage of antibiotics and perhaps new antibiotics still, despite the difficulties, but there are a few things. And other ways of treating infections, we may not go to that limit. Still, it's a major problem. And in terms of medicine today, as you rightly said, obviously, this is a major concern. I doubt that would be a concern in terms of population and evolution of population at a broad scale.
Thank you. Any other question? Just there, yeah. Just there.
We really enjoyed your talks, thank you very much. But I'd like to pick your brain as an immunologist coming from the cardiovascular field, as many of us would be interested in cardiovascular disease also. Many of the diseases you highlighted were Crohn's disease, were asthma, were diseases we're not confronted with all the time. But there's a lot of emphasis in our field about the innate immunity as a basis to better understand atherosclerotic disease. And many of the trials that have been started in cardiology have failed because they focused on either one pathway or one mechanism thought to be very important in driving the disease. So your does modern medicine prevent any selection evolution? So I would like to ask, what would you think would be the best way? Because clearly it has a basic immunological and immune-related underpinning of atherosclerotic disease, but we don't seem to be able to really target it in the right way.
I think this is of course very important. Yeah, actually, since I will have to teach a little bit about inflammation and atherosclerotic diseases, I've read a little bit recently in the field, and this is true. It is obvious that there are many, many different immune pathways that are at work in promoting atherosclerotic lesions and the potential occlusion of arteries and so on. This is complex. This is innate immunity, but T cells are there too. I mean, there are lots of different phenomena ongoing. And perhaps today it could be that we do not understand well enough the mechanisms that are really driving the inflammatory component of atheroma that we can target them. I know that blocking IL-1 has a little bit of an effect, but I think this is modest, if I understand correctly. Please tell me. So it's much, obviously this is much more complicated than that. So perhaps just we do not today have the right picture. So it's difficult to intervene if you don't understand fully what's going on. Perhaps there are multiple mechanisms, and maybe blocking one, maybe not enough to prevent these inflammatory lesions in vessels, I guess. That's just because maybe, so my suggestion would say, as an answer to your question, is lack of knowledge. We don't know enough to intervene in an accurate manner. But I'm not sure about that. I'm not an expert again. So just this is recent reading, and lots of mechanisms describe lots of phenomena, but I don't think we have the overall picture. I don't know, what do you think? But we are far from that.
Any other question or comment? Well, if not, thank you very much again, Anna. It was really a great lecture, and we enjoyed the discussion also. And we invite you all to the reception now in the auditorium. Thank you very much. Oui, c'est